Good evening, and welcome to Digital Media E10, Exposing Digital Photography. My name is Dan Armendariz. I'm the instructor of this class, and I'm very, very excited about this year. This is now the seventh or eighth year that I've taught this class, but this year there are a couple of firsts. One of them is that we have finally, for the first time, broken 100 people registered for this class. I checked as of earlier this afternoon. There's 108 people, so thank you all of you for registering, even if it turns out that 8 of you are fake and you drop off at the end and we end up with 99 or so. I'm still very happy about that and am excited about what this means for all of you and your experience in this class, since in this class we are going to talk a little bit about the technical aspects of photography, but also the artistic aspects. And what this means is that you will end up discussing not only with the staff, conversing not only with the staff, but also with each other. And the more people that we have, I think the better of a community that we will be able to foster. And as part of that, a number of you are not actually local to Cambridge and are not able to join us here in class, which is fantastic. We are live streaming this right now on the internet. And if you are joining us from the internet, or maybe even if you are curious while you are sitting here in the classroom, we do have a Skype username, ExpoDigiPhoto, that you should add as a friend. Even right now, we have one of our TFs that is on Skype right now on ExpoDigiPhoto, and you should invite her. Her name is Shelley, to add you as a friend. She will add you to an ongoing chat room. So for those of you that are in fact watching from afar, can be able to join in a discussion with a TF. And we'll talk more about the TFs and introduce you to them a little bit later today. Now to get started, I want to actually take a picture, but don't worry, none of you will actually be visible in this picture. And it's going to take a while for this picture to take place. There's going to, despite the amount of light in this room, which is an acceptable amount. I wouldn't say it's overly bright, like if it were outside in the middle of the daytime, and it's certainly not the darkest possible setting that this room could be. We are still using a type of lens on the front of this camera, which doesn't really look that familiar. If you're looking at it from your seat, you might be able to see that there's kind of like there's a lot of black on it, and there's in the center maybe a little bit of some aluminum. But this is not a typical lens in the traditional sense, in the sense that we have some glass inside of a plastic barrel and it is going to capture all of the light and take a picture of all of you. It just completed its picture and I just saw that it was really quite terrible, so I'm going to take it again, actually, with this time modifying slightly one of the settings and do this again. But this lens is an example of what's called a pinhole lens, and it's perhaps one of the simplest forms of lenses that we could have for a camera, whether that is, in fact, a digital camera or even just a film camera. And this pinhole lens in particular was constructed using a 3D printer. So last summer, we had a 3D printer in the office. It was pretty great. I printed a little pot for my plant. Some people printed a little stand for their iPhone, and I made a pinhole lens. That was pretty much all we did with our 3D printer. But anyway, this pinhole lens is basically just a carbon copy of what's called the body cap for this particular camera. Now, for those of you with cameras that have interchangeable lenses, you may be familiar with this item already, which is that it is a plastic covering that protects just the body of the camera, not the lens. When you can separate the two items, you have the body, which is the camera itself, and the lens, which is obviously just the lens. You need to have protective coverings for both of those, and the body cap is the cover that goes right on the front of that camera. So this was a 3D printed copy of this body cap, and in the center of that did I drill a little hole, affix some aluminum foil, and using a little pin, pinned a hole in the aluminum foil. And there are a couple of things that result from this. One of them is that this is just a very simple way to make your own lens. Another one is that it is very hard using this style of lens to get any sort of acceptable quality at all. When I show you this photo, which won't be today, I have to sort of keep it as a teaser until next week. When I show you this photo, which I'm just going to look behind the scenes here, which is again abysmal, realize that the quality is so terrible for a variety of reasons that even though it is pointed at the audience, none of you will be able to be identified. You might be able to know by looking at it, oh, hey, look, that was me, but you'll just be a fuzzy blob. So this is actually something that you can construct at home. You don't even need to have a 3D printer in order to do this. If you happen to have a camera that accepts a body cap because it has interchangeable lenses, then you can purchase an additional body cap, drill a hole in the center using any standard drill, and do the same thing. Just affix some aluminum foil over the front and use a little pin to actually to create a little hole for it. I have here some prototypes of this pinhole lens that I will actually pass around in class, and I will also post some pictures online for those of you unable to join us here in class today. But you'll notice a couple of things about these. One of them is that there's a couple of different plastics that we could use. One of them, as you can see, is this orange plastic. And even though there was an orange pinhole lens that I made, this was it was even worse than the other pinhole lens. And the reason for that is if you hold it up against the light, you'll be able to see that it's actually somewhat translucent. So all of the light was able to transfer through this transparent, or translucent rather, somewhat translucent plastic, and the entire scene was just orange. It was just very, very orange. And although we were able to do some color correction, it was impossible to completely eliminate the orange color cast, so we had to reprint the pinhole with a black plastic. Now, that didn't fully solve the problems, because you could actually hold it up and see. You'll have to strain a little bit more, but you'll see that even the black plastic is somewhat translucent, and that's perhaps due to the properties of the 3D printer, where there's the plastic is not actually sealed. There's actually small gaps in the layers of plastic as it actually prints it. But as a result of this, we had to actually use some what's called gaffer's tape to try to block out additional light around the pinhole itself. So I don't want to pass around this pinhole because it's kind of delicate and I don't want to break it, but I will pass these around and you can actually see what resulted from the 3D printing process. Now, one of them, the black one, the black prototype that exists here, was actually an early prototype where we wondered if it was possible to actually directly 3D print a pinhole lens. And by that I mean in the model of the body cap that we were creating in the computer. In fact, we didn't create this model. We were mercifully able to find a downloadable version of it that someone else had actually created. We tried to create a little hole in the very center of that and allow the 3D printer to print around that hole so we didn't actually have to use any aluminum foil at all. Unfortunately, this didn't work because, the resolution of the printer isn't that great, so that was kind of a scrapped experiment. There's a gash in that black prototype, which resulted from one of my friends trying to, quote-unquote, gingerly create a little bit bigger of a hole by taking a knife and stabbing it right through the middle of the prototype. So that one was a failure. So we ended up just using a drill, and it worked out just as we would hope. Now, this is, again, something that you can do yourself if you purchase a body cap, an extra body cap that you're not going to use, and drill it. Or another thing that you could do is actually create a pinhole camera just from scratch. You can use any sort of object, not necessarily a digital camera, but even just a cardboard box, or you can construct a box out of Legos. The goal is to create something that is entirely dark except for the smallest possible pin aperture at the opposite end of that box. Which means that if you create a pinhole camera out of Legos, all you need to do is make sure that it is sealed against light, so no light transfers through on the sides or the top or the bottom, and that you are able to make some sort of small aperture at one end, but also just have the mechanism to place some film on the opposite end. There's actually examples of real-life pinhole cameras that exist out in the world where you go into a darkened room, they have a pinhole camera that reflects some light off of some mirrors and it shines it on a table, and it actually is kind of a fantastic way of seeing very simple lenses. Now, all of this is just a discussion meant to introduce some of these concepts and some of this discussion, but really I'm excited for you to see this pinhole photo because you will get to see it's relatively simple to make, but it's not really something that we would necessarily use in the real world. And it's just that one possible extreme of how we could, in fact, define a camera. Now, I have a variety of slides here that shows different types of cameras that we might want to become familiar with. But I realized today as I was going through this again that the number of slides that I have is actually woefully inadequate for the number of cameras, the different types of cameras that we have in 2015. But I want to roughly categorize all of these cameras into these three broad types. So one of them might be the single lens reflex camera. And this is what you might think of when you consider a professional quote-unquote camera. Many of you might actually own a single lens reflex camera, an SLR camera of your own, or even a digital SLR of your own. And that's due to a number of factors. There really isn't anything special about them that makes them professional other than they have a lot of additional features and they have a much higher build quality than some other cameras and a variety of other things. But there's a reason that these are so popular, and that is because of their interchangeable lenses, or one of the reasons would be because of their interchangeable lenses. This provides a lot of power to the photographer when you need to have a variety of options for capturing an image out in the field. You might have some long lenses to really zoom in. You might have some wide lenses to capture a more zoomed out photograph. But there's a number of features about this camera besides this idea of interchanging the lenses that make it really useful, which are it can be constructed out of stronger materials. It tends to be stronger. They tend to be a little bit bigger and bulkier than their smaller compact camera cousins. But they also tend to have really good battery lives, and they might also be a bit faster. But at the downside, they also tend to be a little bit more expensive, and they have more weight and more bulk as a result. It used to be that maybe even just 10 years ago or so, people didn't take you seriously as a photographer if you didn't have a digital SLR. You might even think that maybe 5 years ago that was even the case, but I think nowadays, the quality of digital cameras that we are seeing in other types, not just in digital SLR cameras, is becoming so great that it is no longer the case that you have to be a professional photographer and own one of these digital SLRs. A lot of the discussions that we will have in this class will revolve around terminology and technology and features that you will find in digital SLR cameras, but I want to make very clear that we do not expect you to have one in this class, that there is a lot of versatility to owning some type of camera that is not, in fact, a digital SLR. And even just a few years ago, in fact, 2 years ago, I sold my own digital camera, my own digital SLR, in favor of a different type of camera called a mirrorless, because the trade-offs were becoming much harder to deal with in the realm of digital SLRs. Mirrorless cameras are very similar in that they allow you to change lenses, and they do have, perhaps compared to smaller cameras, they perhaps have some of these features of their digital SLRs, like higher quality and better build quality and perhaps more expensive and some of these other things. But they also are more compact. And this is a fantastic feature if you realize that your style of photography necessitates something other than the biggest, best possible quality that you can get out of a digital camera, like you might get with some of the most expensive but also burliest digital SLRs that are out in the market today. Now, again, I have to walk this very fine tightrope because I don't want you to feel that if you have any of these types of cameras that it is somehow inferior. They all have trade-offs. In fact, that is going to be a theme that you're going to find throughout this class, is that digital photography and photography in general is a compromise in just about every aspect. And the decision of purchasing a camera, the camera that you have, is one of those compromises. So weighing what is most important to you is going to be a very personal choice. And if you already have a camera, it's a choice that you've already made, but is important in realizing the pros. It's important to realize the pros and cons, advantages, disadvantages of all of these different types and styles of cameras that we actually have. So a mirrorless camera is so-called because, unlike a digital SLR, it actually does not have an internal mirror to perform its operation. And we'll look a little bit more closely at a digital SLR to identify what this mirror is and what it does and how it actually works in just a few minutes. But before we do that, I want to move on to a different type of camera, which is something that we'll generally call compact cameras. So if something is not a digital SLR, which is that big bulky thing, it has a mirror on the inside, if something is not a mirrorless camera, which is still allows for interchangeable lenses but is a bit smaller than a digital SLR, then I might generally apply the term compact digital camera to that camera, even though it may not actually be that compact. So these are just terminology that we're going to use in this class, but realize that there's many different subcategories and subclasses of cameras that I'm sure some of you could raise your hand and say, well, actually, this is this particular type of camera. But generally speaking, we want to talk with this relatively loose categorization of these different types of cameras. So if we continue along this trend for compact cameras, we can assume, sure, it's smaller, it's maybe less expensive, maybe the sensor inside is a little bit smaller, and so maybe perhaps as a result we have smaller photos in some sense, perhaps as a consequence of this could be less quality out of the photos that we get, or a variety of things. These are all, again, touchy subjects that we will address in detail in coming weeks. But again, I don't want to discourage the use of these small cameras. There is sort of this excellent example, which is now several years old, and we continue to see examples like this all over the place, where if you were to give someone a camera and you ask them to take an interesting photo, what is the equipment that they need in order to do so? We've already started talking today about the different types of digital cameras and why you might choose one type of camera over the next, but all of this is completely orthogonal to the idea of what is actually a good photograph. And that is also an important consideration. Like, sure, we are going to address the technical aspects of a photograph, making sure you get the exposure just right, making sure that you recreate the saturation and the contrast of the scene in the way that you see it, or perhaps artistically conflate or inflate, rather, the saturation to give it a little bit more of a wow factor to your particular images. But that doesn't mean that that image is necessarily interesting. And some projects we see totally skirt the idea of a high quality photograph, but still you get an interesting photo as a result. This is, some of you may laugh at me, but this is actually one of the reasons why I really like Instagram, is that if you block all of the people that take photos of their dogs and of their dinner, you actually will find that despite the, and perhaps in spite of the limitations that Instagram provided, and I use the past tense because they've now lifted a lot of the restrictions that they used to have, that you can actually force people to get really interesting photographs. They can capture very interesting aspects of their lives and put it in this really confining squares, relatively small photograph that's just a small snippet of that particular moment. And this, again, is totally independent of the type of quality that they were able to get out of their camera. I used the past tense just a second ago because now Instagram, I think just recently in the past week, has released an update that allows you to use non-square images. So you can actually have taller images or you can actually have wider images, which is, I think, great in one sense, but I'm also going to miss taking a photo and trying to find what crop would fit that square aspect ratio while preserving the character of that photo. That's not an easy thing to do, is to try to take a photograph that was perhaps a wide panoramic shot and to find the center square or some square portion of that image that that really captures the essence of that particular scene. But anyway, I digress. There's examples such as this project where they being some group that I have now forgotten, but we will post but you can see this in the link here for more details. They gave one-time use film cameras to a small village in Lesotho and asked them just to take photos of their lives and just capture their everyday lives. And some of the photos that results were really, truly phenomenal, very interesting and fantastic look into the lives of these villagers, even though they may not have any formal training in photography. So this is not to be an argument against this class. I'm not saying that you need no training whatsoever to go take an interesting photograph, but just realize that photography is a very general art form that many people can take a natural liking to. And I think one of the things that we will find here in class is that a lot of us have very different levels of experience coming into this class. Some of you may have an interest in digital photography, but haven't really gone beyond, say, your smartphones or perhaps a compact camera and really want to go into some of the more technical aspects of digital photography. Perhaps some of you are coming into this class with a lot more experience and you already have a digital SLR and you've been using it for a couple years. You consider yourself a serious hobbyist. You're also welcome in this class. There's a lot of different experience that of students that come into this class, and I think all of you will be able to find something to take away from it, especially when we start talking about critiques and being able to take photographs that you have taken, post them online, and getting feedback from your peers. And we'll talk more about that in just a little bit. Now, to come back to this idea of the different types of cameras, we talked about digital SLRs and mirrorless cameras and compact cameras. But nowadays, even smartphones are becoming a legitimate way to take photographs. It happened to be the case that even a few years ago, it was very hard to get a good quality photograph out of your camera phone. But now you definitely can, especially the most recent phones that have come out have sensors with more megapixels than in any camera I've ever bought, something like 20 megapixels or something. It's ludicrous. It's crazy how good of a quality we are getting out of smartphones these days. And I don't want to conflate the idea that more megapixels is better. In fact, we make an argument against that later on in the class. But it is one aspect, of course, that goes into the mark of quality in your digital camera. Any questions on this before we move on? All right. So, what makes a digital SLR then an SLR? Well, this is sort of the basic overall layout of a digital SLR. If we were to look at a digital SLR with a lens attached from the side, it might actually look like this. And after we remove all of the body and all of the electronics and everything that makes up the exterior of that digital SLR, we can see a couple of features here. One of them is the lens on the far left. There are groupings of blue and green elements which represent the various glass groupings that make up this particular lens on this camera. We see this yellow cone of light that's being focused by the lens and is eventually being reflected off the mirror, which is number 2. So the item labeled number 2 right here is in fact the mirror that makes up this single lens reflex camera. And it is that mirror that is missing in mirrorless cameras, like we were talking about before. Normally, what happens in a digital SLR is that light is sent through the lens and is focused, and it is reflected off the mirror and goes up through a variety of other optics at the very top. 5 is the focusing screen, which we'll talk about in just a second. 6 is a condenser lens, which we don't really have to care too much about. But the more interesting aspect is number 7, which is called a pentaprism. And that is the little hump that you have at the top of your digital SLR. And the pentaprism is essentially just a pretty fancy reflective mirror that allows the light that's come in through the lens, reflected off the primary mirror at the bottom, to be bounced around and corrected and shown through the eyepiece at the very top of the camera. So the whole reason that you're able to look through the viewfinder of a digital SLR and see through the lens is because of the mechanism that we see here, which is the mirror, the primary mirror, which is reflecting the light coming in from the lens and reflected around in the viewfinder to be corrected, flipped the correct way, and passed through the viewfinder. Now, the focusing screen, number 5, which is between this mirror and the pentaprism, is actually something that people used to change in their old film cameras, or not even in their film cameras, but even in some digital cameras when you needed to be able to have different ways of performing a manual focus. There were different screens that had different properties and made it perhaps easier to do a manual focus, but might make the viewfinder a little bit grainier. So that's really why that's labeled here. Now, what would have to happen in this case if we actually wanted to take a picture? Now, you can see that this mirror is actually reflecting all of the light that's coming in through the lens, so we must have some mechanism that can actually move this mirror out of the way. And the stereotypical clap sound that we get from an SLR when it takes the picture is, in fact, a couple of things, but one of them is moving the mirror up and out of the way to expose the light to the very rear of the camera, which houses the film or the sensor. Now, there's another very important piece of this diagram that makes up all of this, which is this item numbered 3, which exists right in front of the sensor. So we have in this camera, the very back, we have a sensor or the film plane itself, and then we have this other obstruction, which is the shutter itself. And the shutter is what prevents the light, even if the mirror was open, the shutter prevents light from reaching all the way to the back of the camera and exposing the sensor or the film. Now, this made a lot more sense back in the film days when, as soon as film was exposed to light, it was its chemical properties were changing. Because of the chemicals that it had, it was actually changing, and so we were actually creating an exposure as soon as that film was being exposed to light. So in the film days, that might actually make a little bit of sense. Maybe you're thinking, oh, some light might actually leak around the sides of the mirror, and we wanted to prevent that from actually hitting the film. So we have this shutter to be extra sure that the film at the very back of the camera is not getting exposed to light at all. But we still see this mechanism in digital sensors today. Why might we have an actual physical light block as opposed to using some sort of like electronic shutter or in digital cameras these days? Another way to ask this question is, why do we need a shutter at all? If we have this mirror that can block the light but would move up and out of the way when we are about to expose the very back of the camera to some light and actually take our photograph. Yes. Timing is exactly right. So relative to the rest of the camera, this mirror is actually pretty big and bulky. And especially in full-frame digital cameras, which has a relatively large mirror, not this big, but you know, relatively large, it has to move quite a lot of mass out of the way in order for the very back, in order for the light to be exposed. But sometimes it's not a very precise thing. There's just a motor that kind of flips it up out of the way, and then we have to close the mirror again when we don't want the sensor or the film to be exposed to light anymore. But this is not a very fine-grained process. Imagine the mechanics that might have to go behind actually exposing the sensor. The mirror would actually flip up out of the way and it might come back down. But what does this mean for the sensor itself is that we could have the bottom part of the sensor be exposed to more light than the top if it flips up out of the way and then comes back down. Or the mechanism itself might actually not be able to be so precise that we are able to capture the photograph in the amount of time that we specified on the dials of our camera. Both of these are good ways to think about it and are important reasons why we have the mechanical shutter in digital SLRs. Nowadays, now with mirrorless cameras, we don't need this mirror. We don't have the pentaprism. If you have a viewfinder at the top of a mirrorless camera, it is going to be electronic because the light is going directly from the lens all the way directly to the sensor itself, and the camera needs to interpret that on the sensor and display it in a little tiny screen inside of a viewfinder. So it's not an optical means of viewing your scene in a mirrorless camera, but instead it's an electronic means. So there's some advantages and disadvantages to this. One of the biggest disadvantages is perhaps that is the power that's necessary, the battery, the electricity that's necessary to continuously leave the sensor on in a mirrorless camera and have this small but still relatively high resolution monitor on. It really is kind of like a little computer display on the inside of this camera on at all times so that you can actually take your photograph. And this is just one reason why a digital SLR will have among the best battery lives of any camera, is because it is largely an optical thing. When you're looking through the viewfinder, there's really not a lot of power that the camera has to expend in order for you to see the scene. It is happening just through reflection of the light through the pentaprism and the mirror. But a mirrorless camera now, and compact cameras as well, must use the screens and the sensors at all times in order for you to actually compose the scene and take it. So coming back to this diagram here, this is what gives a digital SLR its distinctive shape. You have the pentaprism at the top, which causes that kind of hump at the very top of the SLR. You also have the mirror, which gives that SLR pretty good thickness. It really needs that in order for the mirror to have room for this 45-degree angle, but also to have room for the mirror to flip up out of the way. But one of the things I want to show you is actually what a digital SLR looks like when it is actually capturing a photograph. And I have here some slow motion videos that the internet at large has produced. And this is actually a really good way of seeing how this actually works on a digital SLR. So this is a Canon 5D. This is the original 5D, but we can see a couple of things already just by removing the lens and shining a light on it. Now you can see already the mirror that exists inside of this camera. You can see that it exists at about a 45-degree angle. The reflection that you see in the mirror is the pentaprism at the top of the camera, but there's nothing behind the pentaprism, so you can't really see anything behind it. It's kind of a neat thing where you can actually see, not really a scene, but you can see a little bit of the scene behind the viewfinder if you remove the lens or the body cap and you wave your hand behind the viewfinder and take a look at what that actually looks like. But let's see what happens when this person takes a photograph. And this, again, will be a slow motion version of this. The lens moves up out of the way. Now what we're seeing is the shutter, and the shutter very quickly opened and then closed in order to capture this particular scene. Let's look at that again. This time, pay attention to other stuff that is happening that I didn't mention. What are some things that you noticed that I haven't yet had the chance to mention when discussing sort of the anatomy of a digital SLR? Two things we're looking for in particular. Nothing unusual? You're like, oh yeah, I'm an engineer. I could totally make this. What else is going on in this particular slow motion version of a photograph? Are there two shutters? Yes. So what we saw at near the end of this video, where is it? Is two distinct things happening with the shutter. Notice that first what happens is that there's one shutter that opens and it exposes the sensor behind it. And then there seems to be another shutter that closes immediately behind the first one. The reason that we have two shutters is, again, for control of the timing. We want to have very explicit control over the timing of how long the sensor itself is actually exposed to light. The more time the sensor is exposed to light, the more light is collected, the brighter our photograph will be. We'll talk more about the details of shutter speed at a later point. But the way that we are able to do this in such a fast means, we might have shutter speeds up to 1/8000th or 1/16000th of a second, which is extremely fast, is by having these two shutters, one of which can start to open then, and then another one that can follow immediately behind it. So very well spotted. That is, in fact, one of the things that is present here. Now, the other thing has to do with the mirror as it flips up out of the way. So watch very carefully as the mirror moves up and out of the way. Is there anything that looks weird about this or unusual? You can see it also when it flips back down. Right. Oh, let's try it again. Right there. Do you see it? There's like another little mirror or something underneath that primary one. And you can see it. There's this big primary mirror that moves up and out of the way, and then there seems to be another secondary mirror that moves with it. Do you see it? This is, in fact, a secondary mirror. So whereas before we had a primary mirror that was reflecting all of the light up through the pentaprism and showing that scene to you, nowadays we have cameras with a lot of additional features. The ability to do autofocus, for instance, or the ability to detect how much light is in a scene and know exactly what exposure values we need in order to take a properly exposed photograph. Nowadays, in typical cameras that, in typical SLRs that we have now, we have this primary mirror that is not, in fact, 100% reflective. It does, in fact, allow a little bit of light to travel through to the back of the mirror and be reflected off this secondary mirror, whereas we have this one big primary mirror that's sort of sitting like this at a 45-degree angle. We now have this secondary mirror underneath it that's reflected like this, so that light that comes and passes through this primary mirror is then reflected down into the body of the camera. And this allows other features like autofocus and autoexposure to happen without needing to inspect any of the light as it's actually traveling through the viewfinder. So this is, there's a couple of interesting things that can result from this, which are, that means that not all of the light is actually being reflected through the viewfinder, so what you're seeing is a slightly darkened version of the scene, which you might actually notice when you actually look through a viewfinder. You might notice that it looks just a little bit darker than the scene around you. However, that's not sort of the primary reason that the scene looks darker. The primary reason for that might, in fact, be the type of lens that you're using on your camera. But this is sort of an interesting way that engineers have come up with in order to allow these additional features to take place. Simpler cameras that didn't have autofocus, that didn't have auto exposure, did have only a primary mirror that was 100% reflective and did not allow any light to pass through to the back. So this is cool, neat, useful, I hope. But I have some other examples as well that I actually want to show you. This was an example of a 5D, which is a Canon camera and has a sensor that is called a full-frame sensor. This is equivalent in size to a standard 35-millimeter film plane, but not all sensors are made to be the same size. This camera, and these are all old examples, these are all cameras that are now quite ancient, but still get the point across quite well. This camera on the left is an old Canon 20D, which didn't have a full-frame sensor, but was also an SLR. So it has the same style of everything that we've already talked about, but notice that in the center portion of this metal ring, which we call the mount, because that's where we would mount the lens, the metal ring represents the mount. Notice the relative size of the mirror inside of the mount of the 20D compared to the size of the mirror in the 5D. So granted, we might look like we're a little bit more zoomed in on this one, but if you just look at the relative size, the mirror in the 20D should look much smaller. The mount is the same size in both of these cameras, but the mirror itself in the 20D is much smaller. This is what we call a cropped camera because the sensor itself is smaller, or it's cropped, compared to the full-frame sensor that we would have inside of a much larger full-frame camera. Its mechanism still works the same way, as we will see here. But this is actually simpler and cheaper for them to create because the mirror has much less mass. It's much easier for it to move out of the way. There's less, as a result of that, I mean, that engineering fact alone makes it easier to, they can use a smaller motor inside. They don't have to dampen the noise of the slap of the mirror hitting the top of the camera quite as much. Variety of things. There's a lot of advantages to this from the perspective of manufacturing. But there's also a disadvantage that we have as photographers now, which is that we might use the same lens from one camera to the next, but it will actually impact the photograph that we take. So what would be different between each of these cameras when we actually attach a lens to the 5D and attach the same lens to the 20D and take a picture with each? What would be sort of the most obvious distinction between the two? Yes? That's right. So it's cropped off in the 20D. It might be a little bit zoomed in if they were to have the same number of megapixels on each one and you looked at them at the same size on your screen. It would look like on the 20D you took the center portion of that image, cropped it out, and zoomed in on that particular portion of the image. And this has an impact on us as photographers. Now, there's one more example that I want to show you, which is how this actually looks in a film camera as well. So this is an older Canon SLR, not a digital SLR, but an SLR. And this is looks like a big, nice mirror, is a full frame. But let's look to see how this one compares to the digital camera. So notice that it looks largely the same. There's the primary mirror moved out of the way. There was the secondary mirror. But as soon as the shutter opened, we didn't see a sensor behind it. And there's a very good reason for that. There's film. There's no film in this particular camera. But it also just so happens that because there's no sensor obscuring all of this, we can actually see what's happening from behind. If we were to open the camera, not insert any film into it, we can actually see what happens when we take this photograph with this camera as well. Now, in this case, we don't really get to see the action of the mirror quite so much, but there's a little asterisk here. We still can. It's just kind of hidden a little bit. But what's really pronounced is the shutter itself, the shutter mechanism itself. Watch what happens with the shutter. You might have wondered before, and I didn't address at all, how we could have two shutters and how that actually works. Notice that we have two curtains for the shutter. One of them opened, and then the other one followed it very, very closely, more closely than in the other examples that we actually saw. But once that was done, what happened? Both of those shutters moved up to reset their location. And at the same time, it just so happened that that was the time that the film was advancing in this particular camera as well, which doesn't apply, obviously, to digital cameras, but it's still sort of an interesting thing to take a look at. So let's play again. Let's watch what happens when it takes the photo. Now it's going to reset, and the film is actually advancing. Now, there's one more thing that I want you to pay attention to when I play this film one more time, which is look at the viewfinder at the top. We have the viewfinder at the top. Right now, you can see that there's perhaps a wall on the other side of it. But when I hit play, when the mirror moves up and out of the way, the viewfinder becomes black because of that very property. Because the mirror has to move out of the way, all of a sudden, it's not reflecting light that's coming in through the lens, and so we get this blackout in the viewfinder. This is one measure of the quality and professionalism, perhaps, of a digital SLR, is for a given speed, for a given shutter speed that you're taking a photograph, how quickly or how much time is the viewfinder blacked out? You can imagine that it might be a little bit easier if I'm going to take a photo at like 1/500th of a second. It might be a little bit easier for me to just take my time and kind of move the mirror up and out of the way and then quickly take expose the sensor using that shutter mechanism and then kind of lethargically close the mirror again. But if I want to really be able to arm the photographer with the ability to take and capture a photograph again very quickly, that is a mechanism that I want to happen very, very abruptly. I want to, as quickly as possible, move the mirror back down so that the photographer can recompose the scene and take another photograph. So the viewfinder blackout time is just one of many things that results out of this mechanism that sort of defines how advanced or how professional, quote unquote, a particular camera might in fact be. And this could be one of the reasons why there's a huge gap in the price between different SLRs. You might wonder why some cameras seem to be relatively close in features and other aspects, but it might be some things like this that actually go into these small details that actually define some of the quality of the camera. Some other things are also, you might have noticed that the shutter actually has to move very quickly. They might be able to make the shutter out of stronger materials, and therefore the shutter will be able to have far more action. They'll be able to last for 100,000 or 150,000 iterations rather than 25 or 50,000 iterations in some of the less expensive cameras. These are all, again, just various ways that camera manufacturers are able to differentiate their cameras in quality and in expense. Now, there's something that I want to point out again about the shutter. So if we pay attention to the shutter, we've seen the first and second curtain. The so-called curtain are the first and second shutter that we've actually seen, and that's sort of the word that we use for the two parts of the shutter. The first and second curtain might actually have different gaps between each other depending on the speed of the exposure that we asked the camera to take. In this particular case, the first and second curtain were very close together. And so that means that this is a much faster exposure time. The reason is that we have one shutter opening, one curtain opening, and then immediately do we have another one that's following it close behind, which means that every single section of the sensor or the film that's being exposed is being exposed at a much smaller time frame than we would have if we were to open the first curtain for longer and then close the second curtain behind it. There's a certain point at which the camera is able to open the entirety of this shutter, open the first curtain all the way and expose the entire sensor or film to light. And that is also yet another measure of the quality, perhaps, or the distinction that they can make between digital SLRs. If a camera is able to move the curtains fast enough that it can actually open the first curtain and then close the second one in some really extremely fast amount of time, like 1/500th of a second, then that is a measure of one measure of quality or one measure of distinction, at least. I don't know if we really want to equate quality to some of these engineering principles that kind of go into these cameras. But it is one way that they differentiate to the different models of their cameras, is how quickly can you actually expose the entirety of the sensor to light. The reason that this is important, the reason that you actually care about having the sensor exposed all at once to a scene, is for flash photography. If you have a flash of light, it happens far more quickly than this action that's occurring with the shutter. And as a result, if you're able to open the entire shutter and then fire the flash, you will be able to expose the entire sensor to the light that is being shown from the flash unit. And otherwise, if you just have opened the first curtain a little bit or the second curtain is trailing behind it, what you will see in your flash photograph is, in fact, just a band of light. You probably will most often see this as a dark band at either the top or bottom of your photograph, depending on which way your shutter is actually opening. But this is an important distinction. We'll talk more about that again later on. That, by the way, is sort of the second generic thing that we have in this class, is that there's a lot of times when I will say, oh, we'll talk more about this later. There's a lot of teasing that has to happen, but we do have to have a lot of groundwork before we can talk about some of the details. And so hopefully, if you stick around long enough, you will be able to get all of that information out of this class. Any questions on any of this? Great, okay. Now, a lot of this discussion goes away when we talk about other types of cameras. Nowadays, we are seeing increasingly popular versions of cameras that do not have these mechanical, the mechanical operation necessary to actually capture a photograph, like we would see in a mirrorless camera, which completely obviates the need of a mechanical shutter or even a mirror, or in compact cameras or even smartphones. So all of this happens electronically. We are able to actually capture an image off of a sensor electronically and not have any of this discussion at all. But this is still a relevant discussion for those of you that are interested in getting the cost of everything else, the maximum quality out of your photographs, and thereby getting, the biggest SLR that you can possibly buy. There's actually something that's pretty useful about knowing the location of your sensor plane. Here, this is the sensor in this diagram, in your digital camera. If you have a camera where you can remove the lens, take a look for this symbol. Somewhere, unless it's the cheapest possible interchangeable lens camera that you can buy, it probably will have this symbol somewhere on it. And this symbol represents the location of the film or sensor plane on this digital camera. We might also use the word focal plane for this, for the location of that sensor. And what this means is that if you were to just sort of take a saw and just drill right down the middle of your camera, not the middle, but at the location of this line, you'd actually find at that point exactly somewhere inside the body of the camera the location of the sensor. And this allows you to know how far the sensor is away from the edge of the camera, which can be useful for really once you get into some pretty extreme forms of photography. If you really need to know the location of the sensor, it can be a useful thing. In fact, it is useful for us in our discussion of the pinhole camera because it allows us to figure out the focal length of this pinhole lens that we created. But it's useful to know, but perhaps for the vast majority of the type of photography that you're going to use, it's really just going to be sort of a curiosity rather than something that you will do any real actual computation with. All right. Now this is something that you would actually find this symbol representing the location of the focal plane. It's really something that you would find only on digital SLRs or mirrorless cameras. You're not going to find this so much on cameras that do not allow you to interchange lenses because it's not quite as useful of a thing. I think one of the interesting things, though, about these cameras is certainly all of the engineering that goes into it. And a lot of the reviews that we find nowadays include images like this, which actually allow us to break down and see all of the components that actually create a digital camera. And one of the mechanical aspects of a digital SLR, or even a film SLR, that and even a mirrorless camera, that becomes somewhat difficult to deal with is the idea of dust. And dust is actually something that becomes really annoying in the cases of each of these types of cameras. When you have the sensor that is frankly just exposed to the open world, you might get some dust from either the open world or from the manufacturing process or any number of reasons on the sensor itself, and you can actually see that dust on your photographs. So we have here a photograph where I had to physically, and by physically I mean digitally, remove some dust that was present on this image. So here, if you zoom in, you can sort of see there's a little black smudge. Those of you that have digital SLRs might be familiar with this particular phenomenon. You can see it right there. It's just kind of a little bit subtle. But you will notice it especially in areas of single color, like skies, for example. Anytime you have just a big blue sky, you will very, very, very well notice the dust that's on your sensor. And there's a variety of ways of actually removing this dust. Fortunately, modern cameras now have the ability to, many of them have the ability to move the sensor, or just sort of like wiggle it around for a second or two, and dislodge a lot of the dust that we would have in on our sensor. But sometimes you actually have to physically intervene, and I just want to sort of serve a cautionary tale of try not to use liquids. Sometimes people have been tempted to use liquids to clean this. It's not necessarily something I recommend. Even if it's like a special sensor cleaning liquid, it's generally a bad idea to do that. You will very likely get streaks on your sensor. Sort of like, you know how they say glass cleaner says it's streak-free, but it's like almost impossible to get it to be streak-free. By the way, totally an aside, I found the trick to that. The trick is to have two paper towels. You use your streak-free glass cleaner. You wipe it with one, and that's your wet paper towel. And then when it looks mostly dry, use your dry paper towel. I don't know why I'm telling you this, but I found this out this summer when I had to move, and I was just like, it was just like the gods had descended and, you know, and revealed the secret of life. I mean, it was amazing. So anyway, next time you need to wash some glass, two paper towels. Okay, moving on. So there's a lot of this discussion that we've had is about the mechanics behind a digital camera. But it's also important to realize that there is a lot of under-the-hood electronics that can occur as well. And it really is especially important to realize that these are really just computers underneath the hood. Nowadays, it's a little bit more obvious that that's the case when a lot of our photography happens on smartphones, and we're sort of being told repeatedly that smartphones, our iPhones or our Android phones, are really just computers in our pocket and they have a lot of power. But even digital SLRs, and for the longest and now long-running compact cameras do have a lot of electronics underneath the hood that require processing of a lot of digital information. And when I first started doing this class, I did some computation to try to figure out just how much data one of these cameras would have to process in order to take photographs. And it was sort of astonishing to realize that back in 2004, we would have 8-megapixel cameras. You might recall that 20D that we were showing with the crop sensor. That was an 8-megapixel camera, and it could take like 5 frames every second, and it had a lot of pixels, and it had a lot of color resolution as well. And for those of you that this means anything to, that camera back in 2004 was able to essentially compute 58 megabytes a second worth of data, which is pretty impressive for a camera that came from 2004. 2007, we had a new camera that came out. It was up to 110. 2009, the 7D, the Canon 7D, which was at the time just a blisteringly fast camera. It was like 9 frames a second or something like that. It would be able to process about 240 megabytes a second, which is, frankly, a lot. A lot of these analogies now are kind of old. That's like a third of a CD. Does that mean anything? No? That's like a third of a CD every second. That's like, how much would that be? About 1/16th of a DVD every second? Yeah? No? Okay. Whatever. That's fine. Rest assured, for those of you that that understand this terminology, it's pretty good for 2004 through 2009. I do have a redeeming quality of this particular slide for those of you that are not quite so geeky as to know all of that terminology. But I do want to introduce a term to you, which is that if you are sort of looking at the back of a camera and reviewing your image, be careful that you don't do this thing called chimping, which is, you know, you take a photograph and you look at it, you kind of lean over it and go, ooh, ooh, ooh. Like that? Man, tough crowd today. That's rough. All right. Okay, moving on. I have here a couple of slides on, just for comparison, some of the earliest forms of digital cameras. And whereas before I was discussing these cameras from 2004 through 2009, which were able to pump through megabytes worth of data, 8 megapixels, 15 megapixels worth of data, and do this at 10 frames a second or 5 frames a second, one of the very first digital cameras that came out was developed by an Eastman Kodak engineer called Steven Sasson back in 1975. And this was a pretty good achievement for the time, and it's really too bad that Kodak didn't do more with this technology at the time. They kind of let the technology languish and other people developed it instead. And nowadays we don't really have Kodak around anymore to thank for the development of this particular device. But this camera weighed 9 pounds, was purely black and white, and unlike the multi-megapixel devices that you probably have in your pocket right now, had only 0.01 megapixels. So it could capture a photograph 100 pixels wide and 100 pixels tall. So yes, it could work on Instagram because it was square, but it would be even too low resolution for that. But one of the more astonishing things, I think, is that this took 23 seconds to take that photograph. 23 seconds for a 0.01 megapixel camera, but that is really impressive given the age of this technology and what it actually ended up representing. Now, very quickly did we see development in digital cameras. In 1983, Canon decided that the digital realm would free them of the confines of the standard digital SLR. And so they paired up with a designer, Luigi Colani, to actually create these digital camera perspective designs, which are, if you think they look like they came out of the ocean, you're not alone. They were, in fact, inspired very much by marine life. And it is a travesty that these are not on the market today. Okay, let us take a quick 5-minute break. When we come back, we will start talking about some nitty-gritty aspects of the digital aspect of digital photography and also do a quick overview of the course itself. Welcome back, everyone. So for those of you that are joining us from afar, I just want to send a quick reminder that we have one of our staff online right now on Skype. Add us on Expo DigiPhoto. She'll be able to add you to an ongoing chat room. In fact, she, Shelley Westover, is one of the TFs of this course. Right now, we have three. Shelley Westover, who is joining us from afar, actually in Seattle, and she will be doing the online sections for those of you that are unable to attend locally here. She will be doing those. We have two local TFs. One of them is unable to join us today, but you will see, you will get introduced to him next week when he's able to join us. Jordan Hayashi, he is on CS50's production team. For those of you that are here at Harvard, you may know the term CS50, which is one of the biggest, for those of you that don't know, the biggest course on campus. It's an introductory computer science course, and they have an entire production team devoted to that. So we are very fortunate to have him on board, helping us not only with our production, but also bringing a lot of that knowledge and expertise to all of you as well. And we also have Rob McCarthy, who is actually here and joining us. Rob, do you want to come say a few words? Thank you. So for those of you at home, I apologize we didn't have a mic for Rob, but he said that one of the most astonishing things was that he took 60,000 photos in the last year. I don't want to try to recreate the entire introduction, which was very eloquent and was very flattering of the course, but I think that by itself is sort of a good marker of how fortunate we are to have him rejoin us from this class. And Shelley, from afar, was actually did also take the class, I believe it was 2009, and then joined us last year as a TF. And last year she was local, this year she's now distant, but still we're glad to have that continuation from last year as well. So before we go on to some more details about the course itself, there's a couple of things that we actually need to go over. Oh, don't worry, scary math will come in just a moment. There were actually a couple of things that I did want to address when we were talking about the different types and styles of digital cameras that we have nowadays. I mentioned that I was looking at these slides earlier today and realized that this now almost feels kind of antiquated, and because there's now so many, there's been such an explosion in the different types of digital cameras that we actually have. And in fact, even some of the differentiators that we are using, some of the terms that we are using in class, may not be capturing all of the different styles and types of cameras that actually exist nowadays, because we have hybrid cameras that can actually exist, like this one from Olympus called the Olympus Air. Unfortunately, I only have the marketing page up right now. But this is a small, tiny little camera. This is kind of the rear of the camera that does allow, it's essentially a mirrorless camera because you can, in fact, change the lens itself. But it doesn't have a typical body like you would expect. Like this looks like a lens with sort of a slot for a memory card, and that's essentially what it is. It is a small circular device that relies on, instead of a body, a connected via wireless a smartphone to actually control. So this is sort of like a hybrid thing. So you're not actually using your smartphone to take a photograph. You're not using the camera inside of your smartphone to take a photograph, rather. You're relying on the connection between, this connection is not, again, not using a wire, but perhaps Bluetooth or Wi-Fi or something like that. Allows this connection between a phone and, which, is that an upside, is that person holding that phone upside down? Anyway, it looks like it. Anyway, you hold your phone upside down, apparently, and you can take a photograph on this cylindrical thing that allows you to change lenses. So is this a camera phone? I mean, no, but you have to use your smartphone to take a picture. Is this a mirrorless camera, yes, but it doesn't operate on its own. So it's this kind of interesting hybridization that we are starting to see. We're starting to see a lot of fascinating innovation in the digital camera realm with things like this that, frankly, as of today, I don't know how to categorize very well, other than perhaps some hybrid of the categories that we actually saw before. And again, it's interesting because this provides you with if you were to use this, it provides you with the power of interchangeable lenses with the relative portability of your phone. Now, granted, the lens that they have connected to this is actually really quite small, but you can imagine if you connect one of their bigger lenses to it, you kind of lose the portability aspect, perhaps. But still, the power itself is there, being able to change the lenses on this really, truly fascinating device. There's sort of another form of this idea as well, which is an actual physical connection. So this is a device, the DxO1. And DxO is actually a company that in the past has exclusively made software to edit digital photographs. And their software is fantastic. They do some great, great stuff to modify raw images and process them and do a variety of things. But this is apparently their first foray that I know of into the hardware realm. And their version of this camera is essentially a camera that connects to the bottom of your iPhone using the standard Lightning port at the bottom of it. I don't know about additional details, like if there's an Android version available and what the requirements are. But apparently, it allows you to use your phone as a screen for that digital camera and as a controller for it as well. And so again, it's this sort of hybrid thing where it supplies additional capabilities to your phone, but is not able to operate standalone, as far as I know. But apparently there's still like a little screen on it so you can change between movie mode and still mode and a variety of other things. Pretty neat, interesting stuff to come out of this. I hope I will get the chance to use some of this. And if you have used this, I'll be interested to hear about your own experiences with it. Then, of course, there's actually a modification to your existing smartphone that you can use to actually provide the ability to change lenses on your existing camera phone camera. There are these variety of examples of this. This is just one from a website called PhotoJojo, for those of you that like to spend money on photographic things. This is a great place to do it. There you can find a lot of, so other than being facetious, they do have like kind of a lot of neat nicks and knacks and actual useful photographic things. One of them is this, which is essentially a magnetic clip that allows you to change different lenses on your phone. So you can see here, it actually rests on top of your existing camera phone lens, your existing iPhone lens, and I believe this also exists for Android phones as well. But it uses some sort of magnetic clip that allows this modifier lens to snap on top of it. There is an obvious downside to this, which is that you're not actually changing the lens on the device itself, so there's probably a loss in quality. But frankly, look at the portability that you are getting with this. You are able to take a variety of different focal lengths and zoom lenses with you and store them in your pocket. You don't really have to worry about carrying around the bulk of even a mirrorless camera, which is sort of a funny thing to say when, you know, mirrorless cameras are sort of hailed as the compact quality compromise that people like nowadays. But anyway, so there's all of these examples that we could find that these things do not fit well into the standard categorization, but are no less useful or interesting. It's like what they say, the best camera that you own is the one that you have with you, and there's very much a truth to that. It's the one that you can use, and the one that you will use, and that you can carry around in your pocket. So let's move away from that a little bit and start talking about some numbers. So this is not meant to scare any of you away. The math that's required for this class is no more than the math that you would get in a high school class. And I don't mean to trivialize high school math, and I don't mean to trivialize your knowledge at all. I'm just trying to provide an expectation to you that you don't need advanced math in order to complete this class. So even if you feel maybe not so comfortable, don't worry. That's why I'm here. That's why the TFs are here. We will be able to get you through the math that's involved with this class. Now, sort of the hardest things that you're going to have to do in general are just basic arithmetic, and probably the most difficult thing that you will see is a logarithm, but that will happen a little bit later, and don't worry about that at all. You're not going to have to recreate that math at all. It's going to be shown just for your information. But I mention all of this just to reassure that there are options for you available, even if you don't feel that comfortable with math. And again, it's going to be totally fine. This is going to not be that bad at all. Now, in order for us to talk in any sort of reasonable way about digital cameras and digital photography, we need to start to be able to quantify the data that we are actually dealing with. And of course, because all of these cameras are at their heart just variations of a computer, they're just a very specific computer underneath the hood, they operate in the language of computers, which is binary. And we use bits and bytes in order to differentiate between different values in a computer. So at the very core, binary uses a collection of bits, and a single bit is either a 0 or a 1. That's all that a bit is. A bit is either just a 0 or a 1, whereas a byte, B-Y-T-E, is a collection of 8 bits. So that means you have, in essence, 8 different places into which you can have either a 0 or a 1. Now, what does this mean? How many different possible numbers could we then represent with a byte? Well, first, let's think about the bit. We have 2 different possible values that we could have out of a bit, either a 0 or a 1. What happens if we have 2 bits? So in other words, if we just have 2 places here, how many different values can we represent with 2 bits of information? 4, that's right. So what are the 4? We could have 0, 0. We could have 0, 1. We could have 1, 0. Or 1, 1. So we could write that out here, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. We're not going to go into a lot of detail about binary, but I just want to provide you with some basic level of comfort on the definition of a bit and a definition of a byte. So what happens if we have 3 bits of information? How many values do we have? To the third, right. So, and say it another way, 8. So we have 8 different versions or 8 different values that we could represent as soon as we add a third bit here. Now, why is that? Why does it seem to be the case that every time I add an additional bit, I actually have twice as many values? Well, the reason really is because that bit can have 2 places of its own. It can have 2 different values of its own, which means that everything below it is duplicated twice. So here, when I only had 1 bit, I had 2 possible values that could come out of it. When I had 2 bits, I had 4 values, and then 8, and then for another bit, 16. So it doubles every single time that we have an additional bit. So we do this 8 times for a byte, and how many distinct values can we have out of a byte? 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256 discrete values that we can actually form out of a byte. And that is exactly right. And we're going to be reusing this a lot. So memorize this. Even if you don't fully understand why it is the case, that's okay. Just realize that a bit is either a 0 or a 1. A byte is a collection of 8 of those bits, and a byte can therefore represent 256 discrete values. Now, I don't want to go through the actual mechanism that we can use, the mathematical mechanism that we could use to actually convert between binary and decimal. I encourage you to, if you're interested in that, to look for the vast quantity of resources that are available online that would be able to describe that to you. But realize that when we say that we have four different values that we can get out of two bits, what we are effectively saying is that we can start counting at zero. We can convert each of these to some sort of representation in a numeric form that we would understand. So we could say 0, 0 is equivalent to just 0 in the same way that we would count. 0, 1 is equivalent to 1 in the same way that we would count. But as soon as we get to 1, 0, this value represents 2. And 1, 1 represents the value 3. So there's something important here as well, which is that 2 bits has can represent 4 distinct values. But those values start at the value 0 and go up to 3. So it's 0, 1, 2, 3. So in other words, because we start at 0, that's the very first value. And so the last value that we would normally represent out of this, out of the number of bits, would be however many values minus 1. So when we have a byte of information, we would be able to have values in the range from 0 to 255 for this very same reason. Because we're starting at 0 and because that is actually the first value that we're starting with, 256 discrete values is the range 0 to 255. Make sense? Are we okay with that? Is that so far so good? Now we have, this is the language of computers. You've definitely heard the term byte before, but you've probably also heard the term byte with some particular prefix in mind, like a kilobyte, or a megabyte, or a gigabyte, or even a terabyte, depending on the size of whatever it is that you're dealing with. So if we have so many, if we have some prefix before it, that means that we are going to multiply that by some multiplier. So in the case of kilo, that means that we're going to have a value of 1,000 basically appended to that. So if we have a kilobyte, we have 1,000 bytes, how many discrete values can we represent with that kilobyte? So byte is how many values? 8. So 1,000 of that would just be 8,000. So kilobyte would be able to represent 8,000 distinct values from 0 all the way up to 7,999. But wait, you might say. I thought prefixes were in powers of 1,024. So this might be a question for those of you that are sitting at home and do have like some knowledge about these prefixes. And this is where computer science has failed us. And that is because around 1999, some standards came out realizing that there was, in fact, this distinction between some people were using the prefix kilo to mean 1,000, which is in base 10, and it was very standard for us. For example, a kilogram is 1,000 grams, which is, you know, which makes a lot of sense, but computer scientists were using kilo to mean 1,024 because that also happens to be a base 2 number. So remember that value 256, double that again, you get 512, double that again, you get 1,024. So 1,024 is just kind of like a really convenient number in computer science, and there was this sort of bastardization of the term to mean one or both. So really, when we are talking about a kilobyte, if you want to be no fun at parties, you can say that a kilobyte is not 1,024 bytes. No, no, no. It's 1,000 bytes. And what you really mean is a kibby byte. And I think just how ridiculous these prefixes sound are the reason that we don't use them. Like, I never want to say kibby byte again until a year from now when, in fact, I won't until this same lecture happens again a year hence. But anyway, there's this complication where if we really want to be correct, we would say that in computer science terms, a kibby byte is 1,024 bytes, and a mebby byte is 1,024 kibby bytes, or 1,048,576. Now, generally, you will see these terms used interchangeably, and it's pretty safe to assume that unless you need to write some sort of like academic paper or you need to be very precise on a blog post when you argue against somebody that says something that's kind of stupid, that you need to be sure to keep these things in mind, but for our purposes, we're going to use these terms interchangeably, and more specifically, we're going to mostly use these prefixes kilo, mega, giga, and tera to represent either 1,000 or 1,024, depending on the context and whatever suits us at the time. And this is very standard, but I just wanted to point out that there is this discrepancy between these prefixes, and this is effectively, I couldn't let you go home without being confused about something, right? So here we go. There is this additional complication, but we are largely going to continue to use the standard kilo, mega, tera, kilo, mega, giga, tera to represent one or the other depending on context, but we'll try to make it explicit when necessary. Keep in mind that this is generally what's happening underneath the hood in terms of computers when we're talking about kilobytes or megabytes, but when we're talking about like megapixels, we're not talking about 1,048 pixels, we're talking about a million pixels. So even in the camera realm do we see this conflation between these multiple prefixes, where we might have a megapixel, and that megapixel writes a file to our camera that uses a megabyte, but that megabyte is a different number of bytes than the number of pixels in the megapixel. I just confused myself. But realize that the important part is that it's either 1,000 or 1,024 for the multiplier, depending on the context. Generally, when we're talking about computers, writing files, writing to hard drives, we're going to be talking about these prefixes in terms of 1,024. And generally, everything else, kilograms, megapixels, we will be talking about the standard prefixes. And it's fine for the purposes of this class to always use these prefixes to mean one or the other, just so we're very clear about that. Okay? Any questions on this? Now, the main takeaways from here are, again, the bit, which is either a 0 or a 1, a byte, which is 8 bits, or how many discrete values? 256, right, exactly. And we have these prefixes, the kilobyte, or kilo whatever, which is 1,000 of that, megabyte, a gigabyte, and a terabyte. So if I have a kilobyte, we already talked about how this was roughly 8,000 bytes, keeping in mind that there's this additional complication. It's roughly 8,000 bytes. But what happens if I have a kilobit? How many values is that? A kilobit is not 800, but 1,000, because it is, we have a byte which was 8 bits, it was either, which was a collection of bits, or we have kilobit, which is individual bits. Okay, let's move on from that. So with all of these things in mind, how do we actually represent the values that make up the pixels that actually make up an image? Well, we have, if you were to zoom in, which I'm sure many of you have done on your digital images, when you zoom in very far, you see the individual pixels, which are just squares, each with its own unique color. And in combination, when you see them from enough of a zoomed out perspective, you actually get a chance to see the image that it forms as a whole. So how are we actually able to define at every single place? There's a name for this, which is called a bitmap, which for those of you that are PC users might have seen this particular type of file. It's called a bitmap, which is really just a file name that represents this idea, which is really just a map of these bits that make up the colors at each individual location. It's really just a graph. It just has an X and a Y, and every single location on that has some specific color that is used in combination to make this image. So a bitmap is really meant to represent any file type, any type of image that is made in this way. And for our purposes, all of the cameras that we are going to use, all of the files that we are going to create and use are going to be bitmap style. They're not going to be bitmap files, like in the Windows sense, but they will be bitmap in the sense that they are comprised of individual pixels at an X and Y location. And so this sort of lends itself to the question, well, how do I actually represent color at each of these individual locations, given that I can only represent data with zeros and ones? The way that we do this is to split the color into discrete components. And on computers, we do this typically with red, green, and blue components. Printers, things get a little bit more complicated. There might be other styles as well for printing and for press, those sorts of things. But for computers and for digital cameras, we are going to work exclusively in these three so-called channels, the red channel, the green channel, and the blue channel. If you've ever seen a really zoomed in or a microscopic view of your computer screen or just the computer screen in general, you'll see that every pixel on your screen is made up of a red LED, a green LED, and a blue LED that illuminates at different values to create in combination some color. And this is exactly what happens, is that we have representations of each of these colors that the computer then translates into an electrical signal to illuminate each one of those colors on your display, the red, the green, and the blue, that in combination will appear to you to be some particular color. There is a huge limitation to this, and that is that with this mechanism, we cannot represent every color that we can possibly perceive. But with that in mind, we do a good enough approximation. So remember how I said that we kind of have to tease a lot of things? This is something we'll talk in more detail about in the color lecture about 5 or 6 weeks from now. But for now, this approximation is good enough, and it's fine for the vast majority of things that we're going to be doing. So how do we actually represent this underneath the hood? Well, for each channel, we provide 8 bits of information. How many values is that? 256, right, exactly, for each one. So this is for every single location, for every single pixel, is going to be formed with a color made up of 256 different values for red, for green, and for blue. This means that total, we have 24 bits of information for every single pixel, because we have 8 bits for red, 8 bits for green, 8 bits for blue. Maybe this is looking familiar to some of you that have worked with exporting photos in the past. You might have seen 24-bit color on your Windows machines. You might have seen the idea of 8-bit images. All of these are where this is the origin of those terms. When we're talking about 8 bits, we are talking about each of the individual color channels, and this is extremely, extremely common. This is for the JPEG file type, which I guarantee all of you have used. If you are a citizen on the internet, you have seen a JPEG. If you've taken a camera, if you've taken a photograph with a digital camera, you have captured a JPEG file. This is an extremely common file type, and so is therefore something that's interesting for us to know. So if we have 256 values of red and 256 values of green, 256 values of blue, it doesn't sound like very much, right? But this means that if we multiply all of those together, we actually get an enormous number of colors that we can actually produce. If you do the math, I think it's something like 16 million colors or 17 million colors or so that we can produce for each one of these pixels, which is, in fact, enough for us. But sometimes that isn't enough. Sometimes our cameras can actually capture more nuanced information than just 256 discrete values of each of these different color channels. And so some other file types, of which TIFF is an example, TIFF, you might also have seen it as just TIF as a file extension, can actually have individual color channels up to 16 bits. So how many discrete values is this at each channel? It's not hint. It's not 512. Because remember, for every additional bit, we have to double it. Okay, so here we go. We're at 8. We have 256. So we double it at 9. That's how many values? 512. 10 is 1024. 2048. 4096. Keep going. We find out that at every individual location, we have 65,536 discrete values at every red, every green, and every blue channel. That's a lot of information. At a total of 48 bits, that's an enormous amount of information. For us, we don't, that's too much information. For the vast majority of times when we're sending a picture of our cat to our mom, it's not really something that we need to, we don't need to represent our cat with that many variations and subtleties in the color. But it is very useful when we are working with images to be able to have the additional latitude to perform modifications and preserve as much of that quality as possible. And that's another theme of this class, is realizing that we have these compromises and realizing that we do throw away data in order to be able to publish photographs or to be able to do anything interesting with them. There are times when we want to operate in the highest amount of quality possible, especially as we are working on those images, and that is a lot of the times that we will be focusing on in this classroom. So how do we actually store? So now we know that at each individual location we have a variety of bits and bytes that are used in combination to create an individual pixel, and we can probably just arrange them in some way that represents the image as a whole. But how are we actually able to store that information on our computer? Well, we probably need to use some form of compression. And the reason for that is, imagine you have 24 bits, or imagine that we just sort of, let's just say that we have 8 bits, or a byte, at every single pixel location. Now, all of a sudden, we have a camera that can take 8 megapixels worth of information. And again, sort of hand-waving at 1,000 versus 1,024, this means that we would have 8 bits times 1 megapixel, so we would have 8 megabytes worth of information just for a single photograph out of this particular camera. I don't know how many megapixels I said just in the past, but we should assume for simplicity a camera, a 1-megapixel camera, where every pixel has a total number of colors of 8 bits or 1 byte. We can say, and that's not a very useful camera, having 256 colors at an individual pixel location isn't very useful at all, but we can say that that camera then requires 8 megabytes worth of information for every file. And that's a lot. Even nowadays, when storage is cheap and our internet is relatively fast, it's still kind of a lot of information. So we generally want to have some form of compression. So one way that we could do this, it's very easy. We could take a look at, we could break the image up into rows, take a look at the first color in that row, and just remember how many times we have that color that exists in this row as we go across. So for example, on the German flag on the left, we might have the very top left corner is a black pixel, and the rest of that row is actually a black pixel. So we can say, oh, hey, look, we have the black color for 300 pixels across. So we can just sort of say, like in the file, we could just sort of say 300 times black. And then for the next row, 300 times black, and then 300 times black, so on and so forth until we get to red. Then just say 300 times red, so on and so forth. We can see that this would actually really shorten the size of the file because we're compressing it in this way. We could do the same with the French flag on the right, but it's not quite as good of a compression scheme for that flag because we can only go a third of the way through the file before we have to change color and say, okay, so now we have 100 pixels of blue, then 100 pixels of white, then 100 pixels of red. Next line. 100 pixels of blue, 100 pixels of white, 100 pixels of red. Next line. So we're still compressing this information, but it's not quite as good. It depends on the contents of the image that we're actually dealing with. This is called run length encoding, and frankly, you're never going to see this type of compression because of this reason. In photographs that we actually use, that we actually take, we don't have individual colors that repeat themselves for entire rows. We have blue skies that have small variations in the color, nuanced gradations from our sunset, in our clothes, and in everything that we take in a scene. We're not going to be able to compress that very well using this particular mechanism. There's an upside to this mechanism, which is that we can then reconstruct the original photograph exactly as it was, no loss in quality. And we can do so in a very good way for these images that do have solid colors that repeat very often. But as soon as we have photographs that change colors subtly, like this apple, for example, has subtle changes in the red, we do actually have to say, okay, there's this one particular shade of red, and then right next to it, there's a very subtly different shade of red. And then right next to it, there's another very subtly different shade of red. So this is not going to be too effective. But this is the type of compression that's used in a popular file type online called GIFs. G-I-F, you know, like animated GIFs. It's not GIFs. Apparently, the guy who made GIFs calls it GIF, even though it's G-I-F and not J-I-F, like the popular peanut butter. So just keep that in mind, that when we talk about animated GIFs, we're talking about, or even just still GIFs, we're talking about the file type GIF. But this is also an example of lossless compression. Compression where we are not losing any data when we reconstruct the image. Lossless compression means that we are able to compress that data, but in a way that we do not lose any information. It just so happens that it sounds like, it sort of implies that lossy compression, which is compression that does throw away some data, is a bad thing. And sometimes we would say that, yes, that is in fact a bad thing. But frankly, JPEG is a lossy compression type, and you may not have ever known that. You may not have known that in order for JPEG to make an efficient compression of the images, that it does so in a way that throws away data. The reason for this is that the creators of JPEG did it in a very effective way. They realized what the difficulties are, not the difficulties, what the limitations of our visual system are, and leverage that to create a lossy compression algorithm that allows them to throw away some data that we are not going to really notice. Now, if you were to really ramp up the compression on a JPEG to, or I suppose turn the dial all the way down to like zero quality or whatever, then you will actually see what is happening. In fact, here are two different versions of the same image. One compressed using JPEG, a lossy compression algorithm, but at a relatively high quality. And on the right, we have a relatively low quality version of the same image. So what can you notice about the difference between these two? What's sort of the obvious thing that you might see in the right image versus the left? And this is an especially difficult thing, I think, for the folks watching from home, because this image is being compressed again to be transmitted over YouTube, and so it might not look so great. So download the slides off the website, and you'll be able to see this a little bit more clearly. Yes? I like that description. The pixels are better suited to fit the shape. I think another way to look at it is one of two ways. One is that the pixels here in the right seem to be bigger. It seems as though they seem to be blocking, grouping pixels together and performing some sort of simplification on that grouping of pixels. And that's exactly what's happening, is that they take blocks of pixels. Depending on the algorithm, it might be some multiple of like 8 by 8 pixels, and simplifying the information that's contained within it using some complicated algorithms that, that again, take into account the limitations of our visual systems. But at its extreme, we can see how it's actually simplifying that to some degree. It's trying to simplify the color information as much as possible in each of these blocks. And it is then able to write that information and save it in a format that is very small compared to the original image. So we don't need to know exactly how this algorithm works, other than sort of just this generic idea that it takes groups of pixels together and it tries to simplify those based on limitations of our visual system. But this is an example of a lossy compression. And a lossy compression means that if I were to save as my only copy this image using the quality of JPEG on the right, and I throw away all other copies of this image, I will never be able to recover the original quality of that image. It's just not, it's going to be lost. It's gone forever because it's a lossy compression. It has been compressed and saved, and I will not be able to see that anymore. So in general, one recommendation that we have is to save the highest quality copy of the image that you get from your camera. If you care about that image, save the highest quality version of that copy and manipulate it and do whatever you need, but keep that original copy and don't modify that one, because once you save with a lossy compression, and many file types do in fact use lossy compression, you'll never be able to get that quality back. there's nuance here to this argument that we will be able to address later on in the class. So the last bit of content here, before we talk about sort of the overall structure of the class, is a discussion about the different types of common files that you will see on the internet in this class and just sort of in general. One is JPEG, which we've already seen. It is a lossy compression. It has 24 bits of color information. Again, this is for all of the color channels combined. It's 24 bits of possible color that we can have at each of these channels. And it does not have the option for transparency. The alpha column in the far right is a representation of what's called transparency, transparency is, we can also call alpha in sort of computer science parlance. And alpha means that we apply additional bits in a pixel to define how transparent that particular pixel is. A GIF does this very well. In fact, they do have the capability to make some pixels transparent so that you can, even though your image is defined in some rectangular format, you can make some pixels transparent and thereby make your image appear circular while still seeing something underneath it on your screen. This is employed very commonly in websites to create like circular objects or rounded objects that have some particular image inside of it. Now, a GIF is a lossless compression, but it only supports 8 bits of color, and this is why GIF is just not very useful for us as photographers. 8 bits of color for a pixel means 256 different colors for that pixel, and that's just not very much to be able to represent an entire photograph. Now, granted, there is a little bit of an... It's a little bit more subtle than that, but realize that we have to pick from a palette of 256 colors for a GIF. We still have some subtlety in there, but really for our purposes as photographers, a GIF is not going to cut it. There's just not enough color values there for us to represent a photograph. A PNG, a PNG file, is a losslessly compressed file that can support 24 bits of information and can also support alpha, which sounds like it's the best of all worlds, but because this compression is lossless, it's not as efficient or as effective in compressing the size of the file as a JPEG file, and so it will use more hard drive space, it will take longer to transfer, it will take more space on your cloud-based services, on whatever it is that you actually want to use. So there is, again, a trade-off that's involved with that lossless compression. But it is a very good intermediate file as you work on some images. A PSD is a Photoshop file. It's when you're working in Photoshop, you're going to be creating probably a PSD file. It's proprietary, the type of compression that they use, but it's almost certain that they use a lossless compression type, just because I'm sure they wouldn't want to inadvertently throw out data that you're going to be working with as you work with this particular type of Photoshop file. It can support 48 bits of information, which is a lot of color information like we saw in the TIFF file, and it also supports transparency via layers and all of these other things. And TIFF at the very bottom, we've already talked about. Any questions on any of these types of files? Awesome. So a little bit about the course. We have a great collection of lectures ahead for you. Today is welcome. Next week, we're going to start diving right into software tools and light. We'll talk a little bit for a couple of weeks about exposure. For those of you that come in with prior experience and comfort already with photography, you might already know about exposure, but I certainly encourage you to stick with the lectures and with the class, because even if you feel like you're a little bit more advanced, I think there's something here for you as well. But the exposure will bring the rest of you up to speed about the basics, the fundamentals of actually capturing a photograph and doing so in a proper way. At least in terms of the exposure. Then we'll talk about optics and lenses, the histogram. This might be a little bit of a surprise. How can we actually have an entire lecture devoted to a little graph that's displayed on your screen? There's a lot of complexity, a lot of nuance, and a lot of utility that can come out of this. So we're going to spend an entire day actually talking about the histogram there. Software tools continue. Then we'll talk about digital cameras for 2 weeks when we actually go into the nitty-gritty aspects of the sensors themselves. All of the compromises involved with different sensor sizes, all of the just as much terminology as we can fit in about modern digital cameras into 2 weeks. Then we'll talk about color and artifacts, the importance of actually making sure that your devices are properly calibrated, how we actually represent color and the subtleties that are involved and things in ways that we have not been able to go over today. Then we'll have a guest lecture probably to talk about transitioning a lot of these skills over to video, expand your photography. We'll talk a little bit about how you can take your photography and put it online and expand your presence that way. And near the end of this semester, we will actually have a relevant movie night. Now, the expectations for this class, if you are a 4-credit student, is to attend and watch all lectures. We have one final project that will form a lot of the majority of your final grade, 4 projects, 5 problem sets, and critiques and participation. Projects are generally the form of assessment that you will actually go out and take photographs, edit them, or do something along those lines. Generally speaking, with the first problem set being the exception, problem sets will be more theoretical and a little bit, you'll have to write things out instead of actually going out and doing something. The critiques and participation, we'll talk a little bit more, especially next week, but there's more information on the course website and on the problem set. But next week we'll talk a little bit more about that, how that will actually look. Don't worry about having to do a critique or participate for this first aspect. We will, for this first lecture, that is, for this first week. We will have optional sections led by the TFs that I introduced earlier today. We will have in-person sections available here locally and also online sections. If you're not able to attend locally, we will have online versions of those sections as well. They are optional. We are not going to take attendance, but I highly, highly recommend that you do that for a couple of reasons. One is that that is one great way to get your critiques and participation points and also just converse with other students in the class, because later on in the semester, there will be a project where it is beneficial. In fact, I think for one of the projects, we will ask you to work with somebody else. There's a very good reason for this. Don't worry, we'll talk about that more as that project actually approaches. But it would be good for you to form a rapport at least with at least one of your classmates so that you can have someone to work with not only on that project, but just in general with the as you work on your photographic skills. If you haven't seen it yet, this is the course website, digitalphotography.exposed. This is, I saw an article earlier today where someone did an analysis of like the legitimate sites that have come out of sort of the new top-level domains. The top-level domain is at the very end. Like normally we see .com, .net, and we're starting to see like country codes like .uk and a variety of other ones. They actually released a lot of additional ones as well, like .photo and I don't know, just all sorts, .jobs and .careers. And some reason, digitalphotography.exposed was available, so I nabbed it. And hopefully, if you happen to access the website at work, we didn't have a problem with this last year, hopefully you won't have any filters that kind of prevent you from going to .exposed sites. But if so, you could also go to dme10.org, and that will also lead you to the course website. Go here. This is where all of the course information will be, including lecture slides, links to the lecture videos, resources that are available to you, more information on problem sets, projects, where you can get all of that, so on and so forth. If you need to email the staff, please do so at staff@dme10.org. That is active now. That goes to me and all of the TFs. You can email us for any needs that you happen to have. If you are the Twitter type, follow us on @expodigiphoto. We will be posting announcements there, behind-the-scenes stuff, fun things, just announcements, just that sort of thing. It's going to be a little bit less formal way that we can actually reach out to all of you. That will probably be one of the first places that you will see the pinhole photograph that we took earlier today, once I get the chance to download that, process it, and put it online. Now, keep in mind that the schedule, if you have not seen it on the course website yet, looks kind of aggressive in the middle here, with problem set one projects all sort of being due in the middle. The reason for this is that we don't want to burden you with these numbered problem sets or projects when you're working on your final project. But it does look a little intimidating, but don't worry, you have 2 weeks to work on each one of these problem sets and projects. Generally speaking, you will have to devote much more time to the project than you will to problem sets. So the weeks that projects are due, you will probably find you have a higher load in this class than the weeks that problem sets are due. I do also want to mention that for some reason in the past, it has come up that people have the stereotype in this class that it's a blow-off, sort of trivial digital photography class, like, oh, I'll go take some photos. I'm not saying this to, you know, it's not that. People are surprised by the amount of work in here. I'm mentioning this not to say that we're trying to prove a point, but because there is a lot of information that we are going to be going over in this class, and a lot of things that we want you to do and to be able to do when you actually leave this class. And so the best way to be able to improve your photographic skills is to take photos constantly. That's sort of the point of the critiques. That's the point of the numerous projects that we actually have. And so that is really why we're asking this work out of you. And this is not to say that it is an unmanageable amount of work, but just to say that this is, that it's not the sort of the trivial, like, blow off photography class. Just expect to do a couple of hours of work every week, and I think you will be totally, totally fine. Again, here you can see the schedule for the upcoming weeks. We will also post links to the slides in PDF form before lecture, if we can. Some weeks that may not be possible, so you can download those if you want, whether you are in class or watching live online. You'll notice that problem set one is due in 2 weeks. Generally speaking, all problem sets and projects are released with a two-week window. So when a problem set or project is due, we will release it 2 weeks prior to that due date. So this sort of implies that problem set one is out, and in fact it already is. This is really just sort of a setup problem set. It's just sort of getting you set up with all of the tools that are necessary for critiques and for the other aspects of this class. So do take a look at that, but it shouldn't be too hard of a problem set. It shouldn't be anything that should be too heinous to do, but it's there for you to take a look at now, and I invite you to do so. And so next week, we will come back and we will start talking about light and the beginnings of software tools. But until then, thank you all very much for coming by. Very excited for this class and hope to see you next week.